Recording in progress.
Good afternoon for all of you. Boa tarde a todas e a todos. My name is Lucas Carlos Lima. I'm professor of international law at the Faculty of Law of Universidade Federal de Minas Gerais in Belo Horizonte, where the course usually takes place. And it's for me a great honor to be here in this panel with this in the prestigious winter course of international law from Cedim and with our prestigious guest, Professor Philippe Gauthier. I will introduce Professor Gauthier and I will take questions after his lecture in order to foster the debate. And if you want to send questions, send them on the chat or for the students of the LLM here of Cedim, you can raise your hands directly in the Zoom. Mr. Philippe Gauthier, Professor Philippe Gauthier, holds a PhD from the Université Catholique de Louvain. And since 1996, he has been a professor in the same institution. He has taught in several universities around the globe, from Asia to South America. And a very interesting feature of his career of Professor Gauthier is the fact that he also acted in the legal positions in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of Belgium, such as the head of Treaties Division and the head of the Law of the Sea Antarctica Office. Additionally, he became an international civil servant, working on the International Tribunal for the Law of the Sea, and became registrar in that adjudicative institution until 2019. And since August 2019, Professor Gauthier exercised the functions of registrar at the International Court of Justice, the principal organ, judicial organ of the United Nations. Under his period as greffier, the court has had many public audiences also under the restrictions imposed by COVID-19 and rendered important judgments such as the Qatar versus United Arab Emirates, immunities from criminal proceedings, Equatorial Guinea versus France, and the ICAO Council cases. More than 10 interstate disputes are now under deliberation, and Professor Gauthier told me that right now two cases are under the waiting, the final arrangements in the drafting committee. Certainly, the court is now going through a very prolific period of cases and interesting requests for advisory opinions. Very important cases are now in its docket. Not by chance, Professor Gauthier today is going to talk to us about, and here is the title of his conference, the International Court of Justice, New Challenges and Contribution to the Development of International Law. For the students, you have here a rare and precious opportunity to address directly the registrar of the perhaps most important international tribunal of international law. And your questions can, of course, be addressed at the end of our lecture, as I told you. Professor Gauthier, without further ado, let me thank you once more for accepting this invitation, for participation in the winter course. Again, the success of your conference last year was remarkable, and we do hope again that we'll meet you personally in Belo in the next winter course. Please, Professor Gauthier, you have the floor.
Thank you very much, Professor Carlos Lima. That's a pleasure to be back to Brazil, even virtually, and to be able to participate in this new electronic learning or virtual learning experience. It's, of course, an honor, a pleasure to be able to participate in this prestigious program organized by the University of Belo Horizonte. And I thank you for inviting me. I would like also to say hello to the students of this course and to say that I hope there will be questions after my presentation, which I would say should not last more than 1 hour. This at 9:10, I should have completed my presentation. Otherwise, I'm sure Professor Carlos Lima will draw my attention on the time limit. And you know, in an international court or an international tribunal, time limits are part of the essential things you need to keep in mind. Well, what I intend to do today, within the time allocated to me, is to go through three parts. First, an introduction to the jurisdiction of the court, because it's important to remind you, if need be, of the key element of the jurisdiction of the court. After that, to go through recent trends and new challenges. And I bear with me the fact that I will not speak about COVID-19, even if it's a current challenge, but I'm sure if there are questions, they may be asked thereafter. And three, to devote some time to the contribution of the court to the development of international law. Well, without waiting, a few words. It will be a brief introduction to the jurisdiction of the court. It's important to remind that the court, which is the principal judicial organ of the United Nations, has a general subject matter or ratione materie jurisdiction. That puts the court as a unique feature in the landscape of international courts and tribunals, because the other courts and tribunals have a more focused, limited jurisdiction. That's important. Whatever the dispute may be, it may be brought to the court if you consider the jurisdiction of competence ratione materie. And as you are aware, the court has a twofold competent jurisdiction. There is a contentious jurisdiction involving states and an advisory jurisdiction, which is relating to questions asked by international organizations and within the UN system. Well, if I go a bit further and address the issue of the competence ratione personae, when it relates to contentious cases, you see that all states member of the UN are ipso facto parties to the statute of the court, which is an annex to the UN charter. Those states member, the 193 member states of the UN, have a direct access to the court. It doesn't mean that a state which is not member of the UN cannot be party to a case. The charter and the statute consider two other possibilities: the possibility to be party to the statute without being a member of the UN, and also the possibility for a state to make a declaration, general or limited, in order to accept the jurisdiction of the court. This is a very broad jurisdiction. At the same time, it is limited to states, but not only member states of the UN. But the next question to be addressed is the fact that whenever there is a case to be submitted to the court, you need a consent. It's a consent-based jurisdiction. It means you need to keep in mind the golden rule of international adjudication, according to which, in principle, there is no compulsory jurisdiction. If you are party to a treaty and the other party to it doesn't comply with the terms of the treaty, well, if there is no clause in the treaty concerned bringing you to a court, if you cannot agree with the other state, well, there is no jurisdiction which is competent to deal with the case. Because that's a part of international law you need to keep in mind. Consent will bring you to jurisdiction. Access to jurisdiction is important. Not only is a need to address the jurisdiction or competence rationnée matérielle, rationnée personnelle, but it's not enough. You still need consent. Well, how is this consent to be expressed? There are different ways. As I may reassure you, there are different paths leading to the court. Well, the first one is to conclude a compromis, a special agreement, a treaty. And that happens. You will be told that it's the best way. And it's true, because if two states are able to agree on the text of a special agreement, they will agree on the questions to be asked and to be solved, the legal issues to be solved by the court. There will be no surprise, and in principle, they will not argue that the court has no competence. This is the best way, but at the same time, you need to keep in mind that if you look at practice, it's only a minority of cases which are submitted to the court through special agreements, because it's always difficult to conclude such an agreement after a dispute has arisen. There is always a demanding party, a party which is interested, and the other which is not necessarily interested. Because it's more or less 20% or less of cases which are brought to the court through special agreements. Another possibility is to conclude an agreement before the existence of a dispute. And the majority of cases of disputes are brought to the court on that basis. There are two possibilities. Either you insert a compromissory clause in the treaty you are negotiating, according to which, if there is an allegation that the treaty was not complied with, well, any of the party to the treaty may bring the dispute to a competent forum. That's possible. Another option is to use the so-called agreement, which may be regional or general, for the settlement of disputes. Those agreements have for sole objective the settlement of disputes. You have the General Act for the Pacific Settlement of International Disputes, concluded in 1928, revamped, redrafted in 1949. You have also regional agreements like the European Convention for the Peaceful Settlement of Disputes of 57. But those treaties have not been often invoked before the court. But there is an exception. That's the Pact of Bogota. The Pact of Bogota of 48 has been the source of jurisdiction in a number of cases, so far 16 cases. And that's for Latin American countries. Such agreements have not been concluded for all regions of the world. And you see, there is probably action to be taken in the framework of diplomacy in this respect. Well, there is another way of conferring jurisdiction, which is very important. That's the optional declarations under Article 36, paragraph 2 of the statute. It means a state may at any time recognize the competence of the court, and it will create a binding relation with any other state which is doing the same. And it means that if you have, if you make such a declaration, you may institute proceedings against any state which did the same, and vice versa. Of course, reality is a bit different in the sense that the large majority of those declarations contain reservation. That means that it's not just a general recognition of the competence of the court. There are exceptions for a number of disputes. But that means, on the other hand, that there is recognition, acceptance of the jurisdiction of the court for the other disputes, those which are not excluded. And so far, there are 74 declarations which have been concluded by states by the states. 74 declaration is we may do better. And that's also something in your future career you may consider if you work for a state which has not made such a declaration, but it's a exercise of sovereignty for the states concerned. There is no obligation. As I keep repeating, jurisdiction is based on consent. The last possibility, the last option is a Latin, is designated with the late Latin expression, forum prorogatum. It means simply that in some instances, there will be a case submitted to the court, a dispute, but the consent of the other side, of the respondent, has not yet been given. There is no special agreement. There is no declaration under Article 36, paragraph 2 of the statute. There is no compromissory clause. There is no consent expressed. Well, in the system, international law system, even in this situation, there is a chance given to the respondent to agree. And there were at least two situations where such a consent was given by the respondent. Because that's a possibility. Of course, as a legal counsel, it would be complicated to advise that to your country, probably. Except if there would be some prior discussion between the two states and that would be agreed in advance. But it may happen that the respondent would agree. Well, in a nutshell, that's what I would say regarding the jurisdiction of the court. Regarding advisory proceedings, the key provisions are contained in Article 96 of the Charter and Article 65 of the Statute. You have the two provisions in front of you on the slide. And the key expression there is the fact that the advisory opinion is given on any legal question. There should be a question, including some elements of facts. No problem with that, but with a legal background. It's in order to provide a response to a legal question. And the UN may ask that through the authorized organ of the UN, the General Assembly, the Security Council, Economic and Social Council, Trusteeship Council, and also in specialized institutions which have been authorized to do so on the basis of agreement concluded with the UN. I would add to conclude this first part that the advisory opinion and is non-binding, of course, but it may have an authoritative value and it may be considered as part of the legal framework later when the opinion is given. And you may consider the early opinions which were given by the court on different aspects of the law of international organizations, like the legal personality of the UN, the possibility to bring a claim against another state. Those were issues which were not so clear in the 40s and which were the subject of very authoritative advisory opinions, which after that are considered as part of the law of international organization. I should also add that a request for an advisory opinion may relate to a dispute. It's even provided for in the rules. That's a possibility. But what you need to keep in mind is through an advisory opinion, you cannot settle a dispute, because for that, you need the consent of the states which are parties to the dispute. You may provide some information on some background, some legal issues relating to the dispute, but you cannot solve the dispute. Otherwise, you would not comply with this golden rule, according to which a dispute may be brought before an international court with the consent of all involved therein. Well, now I move to the second part, relating to recent trends and new challenges. Well, you see on the screen that what is remarkable is the number of cases which have been dealt with by the court, 179, and which may be split into 152 contentious proceedings and 27 advisory proceedings. If you look at the number of judgments, advisory opinions, there were 143 judgments, 28 advisory opinions. You may ask me later why there are 27 advisory proceedings and 28 advisory opinions. For those who know the answer, there is a bonus. I mentioned it's remarkable because if you look at the timeline, you will see that more than 55% or around 55% of disputes have been submitted to the court after 90. In the last 30 years, more than 50%. So it means even if today there are voices underlining that there is a crisis in multilateralism, it may be true, but with respect to the court, with respect to the court, its caseload, I would say that's multilateralism at its best. For the time being, you need to remain humble. But there is confidence in judicial institutions, in particular in the court, and it is expressed, translated into the number of cases which have been submitted, and in particular recently. For the time being, there are 14 cases on the docket. There were 17 for the past 2 years. So we are keeping this high number. But at the same time, I mentioned you need to be careful, and in 2020, there was no new case. This year, there is a new case which has been submitted to the court on the basis of a special agreement between Equatorial Guinea and Gabon, and there may be more. But you need to continue promoting the peaceful settlement of disputes. It's not something which is to be taken for granted. Well, this steady increase in the number of cases raises challenges because you need to deliver. Justice delayed means justice denied. You need to continue to deliver, and the court took action in this matter. It has accelerated its proceedings. For the time being, there are more or less four decision judgments per year, or judgments or opinions per year, and that was valid for 2019, 2020, and we will keep that rhythm in 2021, even with COVID-19. You may tell me, but 179 cases, it's far from the figure you may find in regional courts, human rights court, or the European Court of Justice, for example. Well, I may admit that, but at the same time, keep in mind that with respect to the court, there is no compulsory jurisdiction. If you look at those regional courts, they have compulsory jurisdiction on the basis of the regional agreement promoting human rights, which have been concluded at the regional level. This, when you look at the court, every case has to be based on consent of both parties. And that may explain also that there is a further challenge. Very often, the respondent, Because if there is a respondent, it means that there was a unilateral case brought by the applicant against the respondent. If it's a special agreement, we don't use applicant respondent. And you will see, if you look at the name of a case, versus VS means against. This, you will have an applicant and a respondent. If it's a case introduced on the basis of a special agreement, in the name of the case, you will see a slash. This is just because there is a special agreement, there is no applicant respondent. But when there is an applicant and a respondent, very often the respondent will challenge the jurisdiction of the court. The lawyers advising the respondent will say so in any event. That's part of the issues they may raise. And therefore, there is here sometimes a problem of delay because of those additional proceedings. But I will come back to that a bit later. I would say also a word concerning the parties. That's part of the recent trend, in a sense. The origin, the regional origin of parties before the court has changed, and you may now consider that the court is really a worldwide jurisdiction, and it's reflected if you look at the number of cases, a number of states which have been parties to contentious proceedings. So far, we have counted 101 states, which is more than 50% of the member states of the UN. If you look at advisory proceedings, you will see that 126 states have participated in advisory proceedings before the court. Because it's the court now is dealing with cases brought by all regions, states from all regions of the world. And you will also see that in some instances, the cases which are brought before the court are opposing states coming from different regions. That's what you could call mixed cases. If you look at one of the recent cases brought before the court, the Gambia versus Myanmar, relating to the alleged violation of the Convention on the Genocide. It's a case brought by the Gambia from Africa against an Asian country, Myanmar. And that's not the only case in that category. I may also refer to the two cases between United States of America and Iran, for example. But for a number of other cases, those cases are between states from the same region. For the time being, from among the 14 cases before the court, we have five cases from Latin America. Latin America was always a strong, not only supporter of international justice, but also user. Two from the Eastern Europe group and three from the African group. The rest are mixed disputes. And you may see that basically all regions of the world are represented in cases before the court. I will also say a few words on the subject matter of disputes. Of course, if you look at the caseload, you will see that the court has dealt with a large variety, diversity of legal matters, basically all matters interesting the international community have been dealt with or are being dealt with by the court. If you look at the cases on the docket, which are currently before the court, that may be interesting because it's a way of capturing through snapshots some trends or the concerns of the international community. And if you look at that, you will get the following results. First, there are six disputes concerning territorial sovereignty or maritime delimitation. Does it remain bread and butter for international courts? I would not say it limitless, but there are always issues involving sovereignty and whether it concerns territorial or maritime. Human rights, humanitarian law, like the Convention on the Prevention of Genocide, there are two cases. Sanction and state responsibility for alleged breach of treaties, two cases. Environmental cases, two. The law of immunities, diplomatic and consular relations, one. Use of force and compensation for armed conflict, one. That shows it represents in a way concerns and current issues within the international community. If you look at advisory opinions, what I mentioned related to disputes, if you look at advisory opinions, I've already alluded to that. If you look at the list of advisory proceedings, you will see at the beginning, the court was dealing with questions interesting mostly the United Nations organs, or for example, the legality of judgment of the administrative tribunal, or the legality or the issues relating to admission of new members to the UN, or the composition of a council of the International Maritime Organization. This institutional, organizational law. But after that, and more recently, there were other categories of issues, questions, which have been brought to the court, which relate to legal issues with respect of which the international community is divided. It concerns the legality of the threat or use of nuclear weapons, the declaration of independence in respect of Kosovo, unilateral declaration, the legal consequences of the construction of a wall in the occupied Palestinian territory, and the latest advisory opinion delivered was relating to the legal consequences of the separation of the Chagos archipelago from Mauritius in 65. That was addressing issues closely relating to decolonization. I arrive nearly at the end of my list, but I would like to say now a few words on another trend which may be detected in the practice of the court, that's the increase of incidental proceedings. You have the list of incidental proceedings in front of you, but a number of incidental proceedings are used by parties to a case, and most notably, interim protection, that means provisional measures, pending a decision on the merits of a case, and also preliminary objections. I would say that's the two incidental proceedings which are mostly used by parties to a case before the court. And it's important to mention that whenever such incidental proceedings are activated by party to the dispute, it means that the proceedings on the merits will stop, because it's important to deal with these preliminary issues or urgent matters before the case may go on the merits. When it concerns provisional measures, it means that there is a risk of irreparable harm to the rights of one of the parties. And therefore, the court has to act quickly. It may take 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, it's quite brief. And those measures will be indicated by the court, if the court considers that the conditions are fulfilled, and if there is urgency. Preliminary objection, that's obvious. You need to deal with issues relating to the jurisdiction of the court, whether the court is competent to deal with the case, or whether some claims are not admissible before you may address the legal issues on the merits. And that's what we can call a case within the case. You have a mini case within the main case, but it has to be dealt with. And when I say that it is often that parties use such incidental proceedings, I may prove it on the basis of figures. If you look at the practice of the court in 2020, you will see that out of 6 sets of hearings before the court, 3 were devoted to incidental proceedings. And in this particular year, those were 3 preliminary objections. And the same for 19, 2018, 2017. That's a trend. It may delay to a certain extent, especially when there are preliminary objections. That's part of the rules which are made available to the parties to a case, and they are free to use those objections, to raise such objections, if they consider that there is no real consent to the jurisdiction of the court. Another element I would like to raise, and that's the last one before moving to the third part, is the complexity of cases. I would say, if you look at recent cases, there are a number of cases which raise factual questions of a highly technical or scientific nature. You may look at the case concerning Gapsi-Kovo-Najimarov project in the 70s, 80s. That concerns a barrage, a dam, hydroelectric barrage system on the river Danube, and Hungary didn't want to pursue this joint development plan, and it claimed that there was a state of ecological necessity on the basis of ecological risks which would result from the barrage. And there were extensive pleadings, over 10,000 pages of written arguments presented to the court, and 75% of those pleadings were of scientific nature. And it's basically the same scenario if you look at the case you are probably more familiar with, the pulp mills on the river Uruguay, between Argentina and Uruguay. There, Argentina was claiming that Uruguay, by authorizing the operation building of pulp mills on the river Uruguay, would create a pollution of the river, which would be contrary to the treaty which contains the statute of the river Uruguay. There were thousands of pages. And in order to assess issues like the possible chain of causation leading to algae bloom or dioxin pollution and other scientific issues which were raised by the parties. When it happens, the court statute and rules recognize the right of the parties to make use of experts. And they can include statement of experts in the written pleadings, the written phase of the proceedings. They may also call experts to make a statement, to present a statement during the oral proceedings. And that has been used by parties that's provided for in Article 63 of the rules. And if you look at the caseload of the court, you will see that there were experts or witnesses presented by the parties in 14 cases before the court. Of course, the courts remain free to assess the evidence brought before it. The court will determine whether facts are relevant, whether they have any probative value, and that's only for the court to draw conclusions, not for the expert. But the expert may report may help the court. And if you look at recent practice, you will see in cases between Costa Rica and Nicaragua on the assessment of whether some activities were resulting in harm to the environment in Costa Rica, on the territory of Costa Rica, there were a number of expert opinions presented by the parties. And not only to assess whether there was environmental damage, but also at the stage of evaluation of the damage, there were also experts used by the parties. That being said, the court itself may decide to have recourse to expert. And those experts will not substitute themselves to the court, of course, but they may be helpful. If you look at the recent decision of the court, an order of the court to designate, to choose experts in the case between Congo and Uganda, of course, the expert will not tell to the court what the court should say, but they may assess the value of evidence. They may provide some opinions on the casualties, the valuation of casualties, the number of deaths which were the result of an armed conflict. They may be instrumental, they may provide useful information, but at the same time, you have to keep in mind that ultimately it will be for the court to reach a conclusion and decision. I mentioned that as a trend because until recently, only on three occasions, the court had designated experts, twice in the Corfu channel, the first case submitted to the court in 47, and the third time was in the Gulf of Maine, submitted to a chamber of the court, in the delimitation dispute between Canada and United States, and even that, it was in the special agreement between Canada and US that there was a provision to designate experts, that the court was free to follow the advice or what was in the special agreement, but at least the parties had already talked about that. But if you look at a more recent practice, you will see that in the case concerning the maritime delimitation in the Caribbean Sea and the Pacific Ocean, that's the case between Costa Rica and Nicaragua, in the judgment of 2018, you will know the details relating to the expert which were designated by the court in accordance with Article 50 of its statute or according to Article 67 of the rule. And the task of the experts was very precise in this particular case. It was to collect through site visits elements capable of allowing the court to determine the starting point of the maritime boundary between the parties in the Caribbean Sea. And I may encourage you, if you are interested, the report is available on the website of the court. You may have a look, a number of pictures, and you will understand charts, sketch map. You will understand what was the problem. The problem was simply that at a certain time, the coast was completely at a different time. And now the coast has been swallowed into the sea, into the Caribbean Sea, and therefore what was agreed in the past was not easily transposed into the current landscape. And the parties were explaining how this could happen following the passage of time. This complexity brings the core to have more frequently recourse to experts, and I've already referred to the recent decision last year of the court to designate 4 experts in the case between Congo and Uganda. Of course, the complexity of cases will also bring additional information, additional pleadings brought before the court, particularly when you look at the written pleadings. And if you look at the number of documents which were annexed to pleadings, and that's statistics, but approximately there were 561 documents referred to, cited in 2013, and in 2018 there were 3,210. As you see, 6 times more or 5 times more. That creates burden for, of course, for the registry and for the judges concerned, but in particular, as all those documents should be translated. Of course, the registry will exercise some discretion and will translate what is absolutely necessary, especially when you look at thousands of pages which have to be translated in the two or one of the official languages of the court. The court has taken action in order to also to organize, to improve its proceedings, to deal with the amount of documents annexes in a more efficient manner. And if you look at the recent decision of the court that was adopted in January 2021, there was a change, an amendment to practice direction 3. And according to this change, the court is requesting the party to attach to its written pleadings no more than 750 pages of annexes. The party should exercise self-discretion. Of course, that's a request that applies to the parties, but the court may decide otherwise upon request of a party if the circumstances so warrant and in light of the particular circumstances of the case. Thus, that gives you an overview of the recent trends and some challenges the court is faced with. And I will now address the last part. I have still 15 minutes, more or less 20 minutes maximum. And here the third part is entitled The Contribution of the Jurisprudence of the ICJ to the Development of International Law. Well, some of you may argue that it's not the work, it's not the task of an international tribunal to develop international law. A court has to apply international law. Well, of course, when you interpret rules of international law, well, you will somewhat develop it, clarify, give an interpretation to the rule with respect to a particular case. And you need to keep in mind that the decision of the court will only bind the parties to the dispute and the parties to the case before the court. But nevertheless, through the number of decisions, there may be a clarification of rules, of the implementation, the way of applying some rules of international law, and it will necessarily amplify, develop international law. Just that's, I want to make it clear, because of course, solutions will not be given, solutions to current international law problem will not be given by a court, but it may contribute to developing tools which may be used by the actors, by the states, international organizations, to find solutions. Well, the first aspect I wanted to develop is the idea of predictability. Well, predictability means that doesn't mean that the court will repeat itself in a number of decisions. It doesn't mean that there is a rule of precedent in international law, but at the same time, whenever there are similar issues which are brought before the court, it's important for the users to know that there is coherence in the approach taken by the court. That if they go to the court another year, that will be completely different. No, there is a coherence in the approach developed by the court, and it's a factor which at the same time ensure fairness, stability, predictability, and it will be used and useful for states which are negotiating. They know that if they go before the court, well, there is an approach which the court will take, but there is no certainty that in all instances the court will follow the same approach, but there is a general approach you are aware of. And such an approach, an example of such an approach is the three-step approach which is used by the court in the delimitation of maritime boundaries. You know that the court will first draw a provisional equidistance line. After that, it will see whether there is any circumstances justifying a shifting, a change of this provisional equidistance line in order to reach an equitable result. And there will be also a test in order to verify whether the result of the delimitation doesn't create imbalance on the basis of the proportion or disproportion between the ratio of the respective coastal lengths and the ratio between the relevant maritime area allocated to each state. Well, that's an approach which is not followed in every case before the court, but it's a general method which has been adopted by ITLOS, by arbitral tribunals, and which has certainly had a very positive impact that creates some predictability, that creates some reasonable expectation, and it may also inform negotiations conducted by states in order to reach an agreement. It's the impact of such approach may be seen far beyond the limited scope of a single case, of just a unique case. And on the screen, but I will send that later, there is the reference to this three-step approach, which was referred to as useful contribution of the court in the judgment of ITLOS in the case of delimitation between Bangladesh and Myanmar. Another contribution is not only predictability, but efficiency. And efficiency, I think, a key product, a key tool in this respect is the possibility for parties to seek provisional measures from the court. It has a relation with also the timeline, in the sense that even if the decision on the merits may not be expected within a couple of months, that's 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, if there is emergency action needed, if there is a need to protect the environment, to preserve the environment, to preserve the rights of the people concerned, for example, There is always the possibility to activate this tool, which is a powerful tool, provisional measures. And the court will have to assess and to verify whether a number of conditions are met, but it doesn't require that the court would be convinced, would decide that it has competence to deal with the merits of the case. Competence prima facie is sufficient. Sure, it should be plausible, but competence prima facie is sufficient. And if there is a risk of irreparable harm and urgency, the court will indicate provisional measures. I mention indicate because it's in the statute, it's in the rules, but you are aware, of course, that since 2000, since the decision of the court in La Grand case, the provisional measures indicated by the court are considered as binding, and therefore states have to comply with it. And I mentioned provisional measures as a symbol, representative of what I would say the efficiency of justice, also in light of the practice of state. In the 151 contentious cases, or 152, submitted to the court, one-third have been the subject of provisional measures. It means that it is considered important. It's an important tool, powerful tool. And of course, a majority of those requests have been submitted in the last 30 years. It's together with the development of international justice. Few words also on contribution of the court to the international law of human rights. Of course, the court is dealing with interstate disputes, but it doesn't mean that it is blind to the rights, interest, issues concerning private interests. And if you look at the caseload of the court, you will see that there are a number of cases where the court had to deal with a dispute involving states, involving cases of diplomatic protection. It means a case, a state will present a claim before the court to complain about the conduct of another state, which allegedly has caused harm to a private individual, a national of the complainant state, in violation of international law. You may consider cases like Interhandel, Notre-Dame, Barcelona Traction, LZ, Dialogue. Those cases are relating to the protection on individuals. And of course, when you look at cases involving violation of human rights, you know that there is another very deeply rooted in international law principle, that the principle of exhaustion of local remedies. That means that the individual concerned should first exhaust local remedies before the national court of the state, which allegedly has caused prejudice to its rights. Well, that may be a bar to access, to have access to the court, but not always. First, there should be recourse, remedies offered, which is not always the case. Second, in some instances, the court will consider that there is a direct breach of the state's right. It's not only because there was a situation affecting an individual, that the direct rights of the complainant state are not affected. And that concerns cases like La Grand case or Avena case, where what was at issue was alleged breach and breach of the Vienna Convention on Consular Relations. And there is a right of the state party to the convention to ensure that the convention is complied with respect to its nationals. It's not just the protection of individuals, but also the protection of the direct rights of the states concerned. And it means that in this particular case, there is no need to exhaust local remedy. And the same is true, and you have the extract of the decision in front of you, when there is a what is alleged is a pattern of conduct of a state with respect to the treatment of a minority, for example. When it's not just a single case, it's a pattern of conduct. There is no need to for each individual's concerns to exhaust local remedy. That would make the case impracticable. Thus, that's important to mention that, because always in the background, you need to keep in mind that access to jurisdiction is very important, also when it relates to individuals. Well, I have nearly finished. The last matter I wanted to raise with you was the contribution of the court to environmental law. It's not not that recent. Of course, you see in front of you the Corfu Channel case of 47, because there is, of course, the case doesn't relate the protection of the environment, but there is a rule which is crucial in environmental litigation. That's the principle according to which a state should not allow knowingly its territory to be used for acts contrary to the rights of other states. That's the due diligence principle in a sense. Duty to prevent. This that's early decision where this rule was referred to. And of course, the duty of prevention, the duty to prevent was also repeated by the court in its advisory opinion on the use of nuclear weapons. I may also refer to different decisions like Gapsi Kovo Najimaros, where there is the reference to the rule of sustainability, sustainable development, which was affirmed by the court. Also, procedural duties have been procedural rules in environmental matters, and it's very important. It's not only the obligation not to cause pollution, but also you need to inform the other state. Otherwise, the other state doesn't know that there would be a risk of pollution. These procedural rights and obligations are crucial in order to ensure the implementation of environmental rules. And you see in front of you a map depicting the situation in the pulp mills case, but there the court has stated that the obligation to conduct an EIA, an environmental impact assessment, whenever an activity is likely to cause risk of damage on the territory of a neighboring country, this is a rule of customary law. And it's very important, as the first time it was stated by an international court. And the court also mentioned that this obligation to conduct an environmental impact assessment of activities which are potentially harmful, that's part of due diligence. This, the court, through the jurisdiction, through its jurisprudence, is developing what is meant by this due diligence principle. It's not only to pay attention to, but also concretely to conduct environmental impact assessment. This it reinforces, I would say, the due diligence principle. Well, we could go on like that. I think it's time to conclude. And I could go on the protection of the environment, but as I indicated, it's time to conclude. And I would say, if you look at the recent trends, challenges of the court? Well, there are positive developments. There may be less positive developments. I will start with the less positive. That's if you look at the instruments which may provide access to the court, they are not developing recently. I mean, there are not more compromissory clauses included in treaties. If you compare with the time where the UNCLOS was negotiated and there was a whole part of the convention dealing with the settlement of disputes, it's not anymore the trend. And negotiators, when they negotiate treaties, look at the clause for the settlement of dispute a bit too late. And they could pay attention at an early stage to the need of inserting proper clause and robust mechanisms, because whenever such mechanisms are inserted, they are used. But this, there is a decline of new treaties containing compromissory clause. Is that something we need to pay attention to? But the good news is that first, the court is able to adjust to situations like COVID-19 and without losing its efficiency and without really delay in discharging its tasks. And also the good news is that if you look at the caseload and the cases on the docket, you should be convinced that the court is really dealing with a remarkable number of cases. It's a sign of its vitality. And as indicated, the recent years were really the golden years. In 11 years, 31 contentious cases were brought before the court. That's unchallenged. This, I would like to end with on this positive tone, but at the same time, we need to keep in mind that nothing is to be taken for granted in international relations. This, we need to continue explaining, convincing, showing that recourse to the peaceful settlement of international dispute has tremendous advantages and it's cost effective. Just on that tone, I will end my presentation. And thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Gauthier, for your brilliant lecture. I listening to you, I recalled a phrase in the Charles de Vichy, a course in the Hague Academy, to quote a national. And he says that if it's true that the International Court of Justice contributes indirectly to the maintenance of the peace, it certainly, en revanche, contributes significantly to the development of international law. And I think that, as you shown in your conference today, there are several points, there are several things that have been developed. And if you consider, for instance, the influence of the ICJ in other courts and how other courts pay attention and other organs of international relations, such as the International Law Commission, we can see that your main thesis in this conference rings true, because it's notable the kind of influence that a court can have also in the development of international law, let aside the influence in the specific dispute that it is called to settle. We have some questions here in the audience. I have a question of my own, and I'd like to start with it. But would you prefer to take more than one question in turn, or would you, how do you prefer to receive the questions, Professor?
No, thank you. Perhaps there could be two, three questions, and after that, with the PowerPoint, perhaps I would stop sharing the screen.
Yes, that's
okay.
Yes, perfect. That would be nice.
I think that's all perfect. Right. Yeah.
Thank you, Professor. My question to you, I think that's a question that you probably hear a lot, but I cannot take this occasion. I cannot avoid taking this occasion to ask you this, because you work in another international tribunal, the International Tribunal for the Law of the Sea, and you occupy the same function in the ICJ. My question to you is, what would you say that are the main difference of the work of the courts, or there are no difference at all? But especially right now, you've been there for almost 3 years. Actually, August, you are completing 2 years right now. Yeah, you are completing 2 years. And right now, after these 2 years, what your perception changed from your initial work? How would you say that the work of the two courts are more or less connected in this regard? The second question I have here from the audience, from Rafael Melo, a student from the Minas Gerais, and he says, I would like to ask Monsieur Gauthier whether he thinks that the individual and dissenting opinions of judges play a role in the development of international law by the ICJ, and what role would that be? That is the second question. I ask to our students here that are in the Zoom, if they have any questions, like to raise their hands, to ask a question to Professor Gauthier. Not yet, so I will take another question from the chat. That is, what would you say that is the application of the principle of the good administration of justice in the activities of the registry? I think that this is a very specific question from someone that apparently follows the ICJ's case law. Professor Gauthier, you have the floor. This is the beginning of our debate.
Thank you very much, Professor Carlos Lima. Well, your question is a bit complicated. Difficult to answer. The tribunal which I serve for 22 years is an institution dear to me, and the court too. It's good to experience the best of two worlds. To be serious, I think the ITLOS is a specialized court, and it's reflected in the statute, the way the judges are elected. Also the way of bringing a case to ITLOS is very much dependent on the convention. If you look at the case history, the case load, there is not so much special agreement. If there were special agreements, it's because there was a mandatory arbitration. Because it's really within this sphere that the competence of the tribunal has developed, and rightly so. But to give you a comparison, no case has been submitted to the court on the basis of Part 15. But all cases have been submitted to, or majority of cases have been submitted to ITLOS on the basis of Part 15. Those two systems coexist. The court is the world court, has the full competence, and it may also be the reason why states will naturally select the court where there is a mixed dispute, a dispute involving sovereignty over islands, land boundary, and maritime delimitation. That's what is very attractive when you look at the court. That's the fact that there is this general competence which leaves practically no matter out of the jurisdiction of the court. That's very important to keep that in mind. But if you look at the recent decisions, there is enough room for the two institutions, keeping in mind the specialized area. And there is a committee between institutions. I think there is a cross reference and between the two judicial institutions, but I think they are they have users on different territories. And the source of the cases brought before the court, for example, will be, besides special agreements, that will be optional declaration or compromissory clause and not really part 15, even if there are a number of cases involving law of the sea matters before the court, of course. It's just a response. I hope I didn't escape your question. Regarding the second one, dissenting opinion or declaration or separate opinion, the role in the development of international law, I would say, first, there may be declarations or opinions which will be noted and will be referred to later because it's a piece of legal literature. And therefore, they have merits by themselves. That may be, that's a good piece of legal literature. Otherwise, I would say what is useful is to look at those opinions and declarations to understand better how the court will reach a decision, which issues were disputed between the judges, because sometimes that transpires from the declaration or the opinions. That's good for those who are searching on the issue at stake, also for those advising the parties. That's interesting to see that there were different views expressed. But on the role by itself, what matters is the decision, of course. But if you look even with the advisory opinions, there are also opinions and declarations. If you look at the declarations or opinions made by some judges on the advisory opinion on the legal personality of the UN, that's very enlightening. You understand better the court reached such a decision. That may be very interesting, but the impact on the development of international law is limited, I would say. But sometimes it's a very good piece of literature, and which will be used like that also later. But if you are advising a state, you always prefer to refer to the decision rather than to an opinion, which is from the minority. Because the other side may tell you, yes, that's beautiful what you say, but that was not endorsed by the court. For the good administration of justice, well, as regards the registry, it's the job really of the registry and also of the registrar that to ensure that it functions efficiently. It means that you need to have a framework, a clear framework, rules in place, because it's when they are rules in place and confidence from among the staff that you may go ahead. You need to ensure a budget, enough personnel, a building. That's really a primum vivere. You need to ensure that and to make sure that the infrastructure will function. And in addition, really to have a legal framework where everybody knows its rights and duties. And it's not always so easy. Huh? It's easier to say than to put in motion. For example, with COVID-19, you need to adjust immediately whether teleworking is mandatory or not. What does it mean? Does that implies reaction? And also for good administration of justice, the registry has to be able to react quickly. If you have a procedural issue which arises today, which needs to be settled in order to go ahead with the case, well, the registry has to be active to produce a note, a memo, send to the president in order to provide background information. The decision is for the court to take, but at least to be helpful. That would be my remarks in this respect.
Thank you, Professor Gauthier. And I completely agree with you that sometimes regarding the advisory and dissenting opinions, sometimes you have this impression that the dissenters, that's in every court in the world, not only the ICJ, the dissenters are there to make a position, and perhaps this position will be to tomorrow's law. But apparently, sometimes this is not exactly the case, especially in the case law of international tribunals, where you do not have the chance to change that much because of a number of reasons. That's very interesting. And we have a last round of questions. I hope that we have time. I think we have. Gabriela Maia is asking you this. Professor, I'd like to ask, you've mentioned a recent decrease in the number of treaties with compromissory clause. Why is that happening, and what are the possible consequences of it? This is our first question. The second question regards an assertion that you made in relation to multilateralism, that are those voices that are saying that multilateralism is weakening. And what would be the effects of this phenomenon general to international courts, perhaps not only to ICJ? Your point in your lecture was the cases continue, the court is working, and justice is still going on. But perhaps generally this can affect the perception of international law or the work of the courts. Or what would be your view in this point? And the last question, of course, I had a personal question to ask you about experts, because it's a topic that I like that very much, and I know that you've published in the field. But I think that there are more important questions to the students that are following this course. That is, what would be the piece of advice that you'd left for the students, Brazilian, Latin American students that want to dedicate to work in international law? What would be the most important advice that you'd leave for them that they could bring from your personal experience, your activities in international scene? I like very much your last point, that was you have sometimes to repeat the arguments, to continue to keep reinforcing some institutions and some discourses that are at the center of international level. But this is one piece of advice I would ask you. What should you leave for our students that are following the course? Thank you, Professor.
Okay. Thank you so much. Well, I hope I didn't look like too alarming, because the two first questions are a bit on this tone, which is not the most positive, I would say. But I would like first to reassure the student who asked the first question, in the sense that there are 300 plus treaties, existing treaties, containing compromissory clause. There are treaties containing parts dealing with the settlement of disputes which have not yet been used vis-a-vis the court. I mentioned UNCLOS, part 15. If I'm not wrong, there are 28 states which made declaration choosing the ICJ. But so far, no case has been brought before the ICJ on that basis, on the basis of declarations under Article 287 of UNCLOS. Thus, there is potential. There are 74 optional declarations. That's something which is stable. As long as states do not withdraw, because in recent history, you have cases which were not happy with the case, which withdrew from a system like the Vienna Convention on Consular Relations, or even the Pact of Bogota. there is a risk if you don't contribute to the system, that the system will suffer. That's what I mean. I had in mind this period of time, and probably it's related to my personal history, but 82 convention and clause, the part 15 is central. It's another era. I am not sure that today it would be possible to conclude the same part 15. At the same time, you could certainly get agreement on not something perhaps less ambitious, but on a compromissory clauses. But if you compare part 15 with, I would say, the conventions concluded at the time of Rio Earth Summit, desertification, or it was perhaps concluded just after, but biodiversity or climate change, those conventions do not contain binding procedure for the settlement of disputes. And there are a number of treaties in environmental matters which do not contain such a clause. This, what I mentioned, there is a good stock, there is a reservoir, but if you look at recent treaties after 92, there is no much appetite for the settlement of dispute. And there, I think that's the responsibility of the states, but also at those working in this area to be aware that it's something you need to put on the table, especially for states which to protect them, evenly the rule of law. It's not the most powerful necessarily, but the only possibility if you are faced with a violation, it's to use peaceful method to negotiate, to mediate. But if it's not successful, to bring the matter to the court. It was not to alarm students, but more to convince them of the need that beyond merits, beyond substance, you need also to keep in mind that in international law, there is no a judge who is available if you have not planned for it. Substance is important, but equally important is to put into place mechanism to address cases where the substantial piece of law is not complied. Well, that was what I wanted to say. And together with that, I think the second question is a bit similar. I mentioned that if you look at what is published now, or if you read newspapers, you will see a lot of criticism expressed vis-à-vis towards multilateral institutions. What I wanted to say is that may be said, there may be weakness, but as far as the ICJ is concerned, the multilateralism is quite positively assessed, because states bring cases to the court. There is no crisis of multilateralism when it comes to the ICJ. No. You need to be careful. Every time you need to be humble, because you don't know what will be the fate of international relations. But I think it's positive. At the same time, you need to convince, fight through peaceful means, but to convince that it's much cheaper to bring a case before a court than to engage in any other unilateral action if you have a problem with another country. I think that's something which is not always put on the forefront. And if you look at the new, there is a new movie, film, on the activities of the ICJ, which has been realized on the occasion of the 75th anniversary, and which is available on the website of the court. But I mentioned that because during this film, it's 12 minutes, I give the example of how much it costs to buy, I think, a jet fighter with the budget of the court for 1 year. You cannot buy a jet fighter. One, you cannot buy 50% of it. You cannot buy 30% of it. This, the cost of international justice is quite cheap, and it should be used, and that should be kept on the agenda. No, the last point, there is no remedy to give to students, but I would say don't give up, because if you have developed some passion for international law, if you consider that it's something you want to engage in, sure, public international law is not always so easy to make a living on it. Sometimes protection of the investment is more appealing when it comes to living conditions. But if really you want to work in public international law, there are ways, and maybe in an administration, ministry, maybe at university. But you don't need to give up. You need to continue. Well, of course, if you are interested in judicial institution, there are things you should also consider for ITLOS, for ICJ, for ICC, languages, the usual languages for international judicial institution are important. It means English and French, at least the excellent command of one, very good command of one, and a good command of the other. That's something, if you want to work for those institutions or being really advising states in this matter, it's important. Otherwise, if you are eager to write, there are ways. They should contact you. They should contact their professor. They should not hesitate in trying to participate in a number of activities. But really, if you want to work in this field, I'm sure there are ways. And when it comes to the ICJ, there is a program, a judicial fellow program, which is quite competitive. The students have to really to compete for that and show they are the best. But when they are selected, they work for 9-10 months with a judge. That's quite a wonderful experience. And there will be a new call for application in the fall of this year. There are different opportunities also with ITLOS, with ICJ, with ICC, and it's important to look regularly at the website of the institutions concerned.
Thank you very much, Professor Gauthier, for this precious piece of advice. Since you mentioned, the new video of ICJ is really beautiful and very useful for professors that want to show the court for their students. We are hoping the Portuguese version of the new video, and because I usually show it in my class, but we have still the last version in Portuguese. But thank you very much for your time. Thank you for your time. Thank you very much for all the answer to the questions. And I once more thank you in the name of Professor Nehmer and the Winter Course for accepting this invitation. Let me say muito, muito obrigado e esperamos ver o senhor em Belo Horizonte ano que vem. Thank you very much.
I share your hope and I thank you for this wonderful experience. And I thank also the students for the questions. That was a challenge to me. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Goodbye.
Thank you, Professor.
Thank you. Thank you.
Obrigada, Professor Lucas.
Obrigado.
Um prazer, Fernando.
Oui.
Au revoir, monsieur.
Au revoir. À bientôt.